This is a test, okay.
I
Acting CFO.
Yeah, no, go ahead. Yeah, absolutely.
Hey.
We did. Blair did.
Good to see you.
How are you guys?
Good morning. Thank you all.
Yes, no, thank you.
As usual. Hey, good morning. How are you?
Yeah, we can move what? I wish you would have gone.
Thank you.
I really do, but I also understand.
Yeah.
Totally.
Thank you, Lana.
Did you really?
I did. It was wonderful.
Well, we want to go back. We want to go back and do.
We studied in, I studied in Florence. My husband and I went back 2 years ago. We did 12 days. We did, we flew in and out of Rome, but then we went up to Florence, and that's where it started.
Okay. So we want to do that.
Yeah.
But we.
Yeah.
Well, you're, we went to Paris.
Yeah.
There's all sort of bills at the same.
Yeah.
That bill is possible. Rome is all these.
It's such a variety.
How are you, Joan?
Good. How are you, Mr. Director?
Fine, thank you.
We're going to go to Barcelona.
Are you really?
Yeah. Our first trip away from a kiddo.
ready, Mr. Pastor.
Whatever you are, babe.
The subcommittee will come to order. Today, we welcome Secretary of Transportation Rail Hood to the THUD Subcommittee to testify on behalf of DOT's fiscal year 2014 budget request. And I note this may be the last time that you testify before us. So wish you the very, very best. Look forward to your testimony. This year, the department is requesting authority to spend $77 billion in fiscal year 2014. This represents an increase of $6.5 billion, or 9.2% from last year, which is a healthy increase in the current environment. Once again, the budget includes $50 billion for, quote, immediate transportation investments, end quote. This is a proposal we've seen three times before and is structured similar to the FY 2009 stimulus package. Also similar to the stimulus package, it's not paid for or offset by reductions elsewhere. The President assumes a total of $214 billion to pay for two reauthorization programs and to shore up the Highway Trust Fund, which the CBO expects to have financial solvency issues in 2014. The budget proposes to pay for this with anticipated savings in the Overseas Contingency Operations Fund, which is, for a lot of folks, is a dubious source at best. While the Highway Trust Fund is having financial difficulty paying for its current obligations, the administration's budget proposes to reopen the recently passed MAP 21 and fund rail programs from the trust fund. And just when you think it can't get worse for the struggling trust fund, the budget proposes a 330% increase in rail funding, the largest increase in this entire budget. To put it in perspective, the budget request would increase the entire transportation budget by $6.5 billion. Rail would receive $5 billion of the $6.5 billion increase. We're moving from one tight budget year to another. This is an expensive proposal to put forth in this environment, especially with no realistic way to pay for it all. Moving transportation funds to the mandatory side of the ledger will only exacerbate our challenges, as mandatory programs are the largest contributors to our budget problems. And using OCO funds is not a realistic option. Many members hope that the drawdown of our forces in Iraq and Afghanistan will provide an opportunity to reduce the spending and the deficit and not serve as an excuse for even more spending. We have the difficult job of determining how to allocate a limited pot of funds among the programs within our jurisdiction, and I'm looking forward to hearing more details about your budget. And again, we welcome you, Mr. Secretary. Before I recognize you, I'd ask Mr. Pastor for his opening statements.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman. Good morning, Mr. Secretary, and thank you, Mr. Chairman, for the recognition. I also want to welcome Secretary LaHood this morning. And since this, as you said, this may be his last appearance before the subcommittee as Secretary of Transportation, I want to thank him for his service to our country as the Secretary of Transportation. He truly has been a champion of safety and also a champion to invest in our transportation infrastructure. And so I want to thank you again for your service, and I wish you the best.
Thank you.
Secretary, a few weeks ago, we finished our work on the fiscal 2013 appropriation process, where many transportation programs were put on autopilot at the funding levels below the fiscal year 2012 funding level. In addition, Department of Transportation must absorb nearly $960 million in cuts due to sequestration that went into effect in early March. While not fully implemented, and as of yet, these reductions will hit the operations of the FAA most dramatically and will significantly lower the baseline for many transportation programs. President Obama has submitted a robust funding request for the Department of Transportation. With two small exceptions, the fiscal year 2014 budget fully funds the authorized levels included in MAP 21 for Department of Transportation's highway, transit, and safety agencies. The budget also proposed a significant increase in rail programs and includes funding to continue to modernize our aging air traffic control system. These investments are important to our economy and necessary to maintain and improve our nation's transportation system. I look forward to your testimony. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Pastor. After the Secretary has given his opening statement, we'll alternate and proceed with the five-minute question rounds. And with that, Mr. Secretary, I invite you to present your opening statement. Your full written statement will be included in the record and be recognized for 5 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and Mr. Pastor and other members of the committee. I always look forward to the opportunity to come back to my old committee that I served on for 8 years and talk about our 2014 budget. Since day one, President Obama and all of us at the Department of Transportation have been committed to putting people back to work, rebuilding and repairing our infrastructure. We have also worked tirelessly to ensure that our aviation, highway, rail, transit, and pipeline systems are the safest in the world. The President's 2014 budget provides the necessary resources to continue and expand these efforts. The President is requesting $77 billion for the Department of Transportation for fiscal year 14, a 6% increase over 2012 funding levels. The President's budget also includes an additional $50 billion for immediate investments to support critical infrastructure projects, such as improving America's roads, bridges, transit systems, border crossings, railway, and runways. Together, these proposals will help us create jobs and invest in the 21st century transportation that business needs to compete. Intercity passenger rail continues to be critical to our efforts to improve intermodal connectivity and increase travel options for the public. 4 years ago, President Obama laid out his vision for high-speed rail. That vision has not been blurred or diminished, and we're working hard to fulfill it. Today, we have trains hitting 110 miles per hour in the Midwest, and the initial segment of the nation's first 220 mile per hour high-speed rail network is set to break ground in California this year. We have invested in multimodal train stations in communities across the country, creating jobs and revitalizing downtown districts in the process. The President's 2014 budget continues this effort with a bold rail reauthorization proposal that will provide $40 billion over 5 years to invest in projects that will strengthen and enhance rail services. As part of this proposal, $6.4 billion is included to significantly improve existing intercity passenger rail service, develop new high-speed rail corridors, and strengthen the economic competitiveness of the freight rail system. The President's 2014 budget also fully supports the authorized funding levels contained in MAP 21. We are proposing $53 billion for our highway transit and highway safety programs in 2014. The President's budget also includes increased investment in highway traffic safety. The President is proposing over $560 million for NHTSA to support state highway safety initiatives. These grants will help us save lives and reduce injury. In addition, the President's budget includes increased funding to expand our bus and truck safety programs. President's budget requests $255 million for pipeline hazardous material safety administration, most of which will increase pipeline safety. And finally, the President's plan provides $15.6 billion for the FAA to continue to support the safest aviation system in the world. This includes furthering our commitment to next-gen. Through next-gen advancements, we're improving safety, capacity, and efficiency of air travel. The President's budget request includes $1 billion to continue to advance critical next-gen investments. Well, so with that, Mr. Chairman and Ranking Member and members of the committee, why don't I just conclude and answer your questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Secretary, and again, welcome, and thank you for the great job that you've done at the department.
Thank you.
After 7 years of short-term extensions, the two-year Surface Authorization Act, the MAP 21, was recently enacted. And although the DOT budget request would fund the highways and motor carriers and safety programs at the MAP 21 levels, which is $55 billion, it also reopens MAP 21 midstream to pay for a five-year, $40 billion rail package from the trust fund as mandatory spending. The FY 14 costs exceed $6 billion, which is a hefty increase compared to the $1.5 billion in rail funding for FY 13. As we're all aware, that Congress didn't receive a surplus transportation reauthorization proposal from the administration. I just wonder when we can expect the proposal from the administration about the official rail reauthorization package that has the your five-year $40 billion proposal.
Well, as you know, Mr. Chairman, the president has been focused since he was sworn into his second term on sequestration, on guns, and on immigration. And I believe that when you all finish working on certainly guns and immigration, you will see a bold plan put forth by this administration, which will include funding.
Okay. Well, we'd like, you know, to know what we're paying for before we appropriate the funds, obviously. And I would, as early as possible, we'd really like to see the legislative text that you're proposing. I assume that's forthcoming.
It will be a part of the president's vision once he's not busy with these other matters.
So it's contingent upon getting...
It's contingent upon you all taking action on three things that you've all been paying a lot of attention to: guns, immigration, and sequestration.
Okay. The Highway Trust Fund will begin having problems meeting its current obligations on the transit side in 2014. The budget proposes to augment the trust fund with a total of $214 billion from the overseas contingency operations. $40 billion is from rail, $89 billion from surface or for surface transportation, and $85 billion to make the trust fund solvent. Given that paying for your budget proposal and the OCO is equivalent really to putting the expenses on the credit card, and even the administration has admitted that. Is there any other way of funding the request, or if not, what programs are you ready to?
Well, look, for 2 years, the first 2 years that I was in this job, you all criticized us for not coming up with a way to fund transportation. So you can't have it both ways here. I know you will have it both ways, but you shouldn't have it both ways. For the last 2 years, after receiving criticism for the first 2 years for no funding, we've come up with a funding mechanism. Now, there really is an account with this money in it. And what the president proposes is to take half of the money and apply it against the deficit, and take the other half and give part of it to the Department of Transportation to fund our programs. This is not made up. This is not a fiction. There really is an account where this money exists. And that's how the president proposes, and this administration proposes, to do the pay for, which you asked us to do for 2 years in a row. And for the last 2 years, that's what we've intended to do.
There's money in that account?
Yes, sir, there sure is.
Has it been appropriated?
$600 billion in savings from Iraq and Afghanistan.
Has it been appropriated?
That I don't know, Mr. Chairman. I assume this high-powered staff that you all have sitting behind you knows the answer to that.
No money in the account.
Well, then you all ought to appropriate it, because it's there. It's savings.
Isn't there a problem with converting all the transportation funding to mandatory and without providing any kind of a long-term revenue source?
Well, as I indicated a few minutes ago, the president will have a bold vision and a pay for once he is able to persuade all of you to do something on guns and immigration and hopefully fix sequester.
My time's expired. Thank you, Mr. Mr. Pastore?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to deal with the airport improvement program. You proposed $450 million reduction to the FAA's airport grant program, AIP, bringing the funding to the, in the 2014 down to $2.9 billion and from a 3.43. Entitlement funds would only be preserved for small and medium-sized primary airports. Non-primary airports would lose their annual entitlement of $150,000 per year. The large hub airports will lose their entitlement funds, but will be eligible for discretionary funds and will be allowed to raise passenger facility charges from $4.50 to $8 per passenger. Mr. Secretary, changes to the passenger facility charges of PFC are typically handled through the authorization process. If the PFC is not increased, how much, if any, does the administration request change?
Well, the Airport Improvement Fund, AIP, is funded at $2.9 billion. And the proposal uses the federal money to support small and medium-sized airports. It also lets airports raise the passenger facility charge from $4.50 up to $8. This way, the larger airports have the flexibility to use the funding as they think best. And that really is what this proposal is about.
But the question I have is, if you don't have the authorization process and the PFC is not increased, what do you do with the reduction in funds? Are you going to relook at it and make another determination if we don't have the passenger, the PFCs? Because this, I think, was brought, about a year ago?
It was.
Same idea?
It was.
And nothing happened?
And it was proposed a year ago.
Yeah.
Sylvia tells me we go back to the current funding at $3.35 billion. Yep. I should have mentioned that Sylvia Garcia is our chief operating officer.
You have a great person.
I agree with that.
I've had a, well, she many times had me on my knees begging for requests, but now that she's in a higher role, my respect continues with her. And I'm
Thank
very
you.
Happy that she'll continue the funding at a master's level. What was the rationale for eliminating the annual entitlement of $150,000 for the small non-primary airport?
You know, I'll have to get back to you for the record on that, Mr. Pastore.
And the other one is, what benefit do the small non-primary airports get out of your proposal, if any benefit?
I'll get back to you for the record on that.
We recently had the FAA announce closures of some control towers. I think it was 149 that were scheduled, and then now it's delayed till June 15th. Do you think there'll be further revisions on the towers that have been already named to be closed by the June 15th day?
Well, this brings up the point about how dumb and difficult sequester is. It's a dumb idea because it's a meat-axe approach to budgeting. And there's not much logic involved in it. And there's not much consideration given to really looking at the merits of certain programs and really making judgments where to cut on whether a program is a good program or not. So that, for starters, sequestration has made it very difficult, particularly difficult at the FAA because we have to come up with $1 billion. At the Department of Transportation, we have 55,000 employees. 47,000 are FAA employees. The lion's share of the $1 billion, over $600 million, has to come from the FAA. So we have just sent letters to our employees telling them that they may be furloughed up to 11 days. Now, these are federal employees. Federal employees don't make a lot of money, but they serve the American people. At the FAA, their primary mission is safety. And so the decisions about closing airports has been very, very difficult. I represented for 14 years, 20 counties in Illinois, and I had a lot of small airports. And so I know the difficulty in announcing that an airport's going to be closed, particularly in rural America or an area outside of a metropolitan area. These are not decisions we wanted to make, but we had to make. And our plan is to continue with the announcements that we have made. The reason for the delay and the reason that we asked the court for the delay till June 15th is to make sure we get it right and to make sure that we can do what we say we're going to do.
Thank you, Mr. Pastor. Ms. Herrera-Butler.
Thank you. Can you hear me from here? I've just scoot over. All right, I'll just project. Thank you for your time. You might have an inkling as to what I'm going to ask you about. It's about the Columbia River Crossing Project in Portland. And we've talked about this. You were recently out in my state ledge talking to the state lawmakers about whether or not to fund this project. And you've made it clear it's an Obama administration priority. I understand that there are about three New Starts programs that have not received full funding grant agreements, but is still a priority. They're still receiving money, even though they haven't had the grant sign-off. This is one of them. And I wanted to point out a couple of things and get your take, because I have some real concerns with how this project is moving forward. And having just heard you talk about the negative impacts, as you see on so because of sequestration, I think it's really, these are salient points for you to consider as you are promoting this project in its current form. One of the things that I've just asked the project sponsors about, you know, in Seattle, the big controversy over this bridge is that, and the administration is promoting this, is the light rail piece. You know, a lot of us are beginning to call for a bus rapid transit instead because it's more cost effective. Everybody knows the bridge is a federal responsibility. It's on I-5, connects Canada to Mexico. It's the last drawbridge on I-5. So the fact that we need to change it and make it safe, I don't think is the argument. It's what it looks like. And it seems like a lot of folks from outside our region keep promoting the light rail piece. We're starting to say bus rapid transit is more cost effective, and the numbers seem to bear out. In the last about 5 years, the average per mile cost of light rail nationwide is about $35 million. There's been two projects in our neck of the woods that have significantly exceeded that. One is in Portland, where it's $179 million per light rail mile. And one is the latest one is in Portland, which is $204 million per light rail mile. And these are really expensive, partially because the soil and there was elevated pieces and they had to tunnel, significant environmental there were a lot of challenges. So it's not usually this expensive. However, the plan that the administration is promoting right now would be the most expensive in the nation at $293 million for a 2.9 mile expansion. So it's $293 million per mile for light rail on this bridge. My biggest concern is my constituents and whether they're going to have to pay the cost overruns here, because there's no justification for these numbers. In fact, if you look at how this money is going to be spent, $7 million would be spent on a Hood River Channel restoration 60 miles east of the facility, $10 million for a curation facility, also known as a museum, $3 million for Oregon's Mass Transit Organization TriMet in South Portland. So as you can see, there's a lot of stuff built into this cost that the administration is so promoting. And I hear you talk about cuts and costs and overruns elsewhere. I guess I would ask, do you think this is all worth it for a 1 minute off the commute time that this bridge and this project would save according to the CRC's own documents?
Well, first of all, we're not building the bridge to get somewhere faster. That's
for
starting.
That's been one of the reasons it's been sold.
DOT has never promoted building anything to get anywhere faster. We don't promote things to get places faster. We don't promote building roads or bridges to get places faster. What we've promoted is the idea that for 10 years, people in the region mm-hmm. have planned this. We have not tried to, the people in the region decided what this project would be.
So can I challenge you on that, Mr. Secretary?
Well, you can, but at some point I'd like to finish answering your question. But if you want to challenge me, go ahead.
Well, just on that statement, because this is an incredibly important issue for my biggest county. We are still hovering around double-digit unemployment. We have been for 4 years. They're going to pay the lion's share portion of this cost. And these people, just in November, voted down the local matching tax that is required, under my understanding, for a New Starts grant. So, yes, there are those, particularly from outside of this county, that have called for light rail to come into Clark County. But it's not, I guess, I think you need to understand, it's not this county that's asked for it.
This is not a county bridge. This is a regional bridge.
So
this
then,
is, this,
so are, is the department going to pick up the cost overruns that come
This is
it?
Not a county bridge. It's a regional bridge. It connects two states over the Columbia River. It's an unsafe bridge. It's a bridge that needs to be replaced. Mm-hmm. There's no dispute about any of that. This is not a one-county bridge. This is a bridge that connects North America from Canada to Mexico. This is a regional approach. It's a two-state approach. It's been in the planning for 10 years. Now, we didn't make up the idea that there ought to be a transit line. That was done by the people over a 10-year period who planned the bridge. If you all in the region decide that you don't want a transit line, so be it. But you're going to start over. It's going to take you another 10 years to plan what you want. And it's I think, for the people that have been planning it for 10 years, it's a little bit of slap in the face. But if things have changed and the people that planned this over 10 years want to change the design of the bridge, so be it. We'll take our money and go somewhere else, and you can all start over with the environmental impact statement and take 10 years to plan a bridge that needs to be replaced now, that people have worked on for 10 years.
We'll do another round.
We'll do another round.
Thank you.
Gentlewoman's time has expired. Mr. Quigley.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good morning, Mr. Secretary.
Good morning.
Thank you for your service.
Thank you.
Speaking on behalf of the mayor of the city of Chicago, we'll take that money. When I got on this committee, I talked about the region all the time, as you are, and of course he reminded me that by the word region I mean Chicago. So once I understood that, I was just fine. Let me ask you a question relating to something you had touched on before, but let me ask it in a way that you can give a very succinct answer to. The president's budget allows for an increase in the passenger facility charge up to $8 for the large hub airports, given that they would give some of that back to FAA so that they go to the smaller regional airports for their infrastructure needs. Just how critical is that increase to smaller airports and the larger airports in the coming years?
Well, we know that airports all over the country, whether it's O'Hare or Peoria or other large hub airports, all are, over the next several years, going to need some modernization. Some will need additional runways. Some will need to lengthen runways. And these airports, whether they're in Chicago or in Peoria, are an economic engine for the community. They provide jobs. And we want to recognize that we're not just going to fund the big airports, but we have an obligation to work with the smaller airports too.
Right, and this fee hasn't been increased since 2000, I believe. That's correct.
Yes.
Let me ask you another question about positive train control. As you know, the Rail Safety Act in 2008 mandated that this be in place by, I think, 2015. We're now hearing from the Federal Railroad Administration, CRS, and the GAO. The Ball published reports saying this isn't going to happen. Your thoughts on whether or not...
It's going to happen. This is our number one rail safety program. Positive train control is about safety. Our number one agenda, what we get up every day and think about at DOT, is safety. This will be done.
I'm not arguing one point or another. I guess the question I'm asking is, it appears that both freight and commuter rail are saying they don't have the time or the resources to get this done in time. So how do we get to this point by 2015?
Well, I think that, I don't know about the time part, but this is an expensive proposition.
I mean, I want to get
And again, done. This is not something that we made up at DOT. Congress passed this, and they passed it on the safety aspect of it.
And I'm not questioning that at all, Mr. Secretary, and I'm all for safety. But you raised a nuance there when you said the timing issue, and I think that's all anyone is raising now. I just want to know, is it possible to get it done by 2015, and what would it take to get it done by that time?
Our goal is to get this done. Obviously, we need the resources to get it done, and it's our number one rail priority.
Okay. I look forward to working with you. If it's going out to get the resources, fine. If it's working with my freight and passenger lines that run through our district and our region, I'd be glad to work with you.
Thank
and
you.
Them. But I guess the only question is not whether it's getting done, it's how the heck do we get it done by 2015?
It'll be difficult, but we have that as a goal.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Secretary. I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Quigley. I don't like the sequester any more than you do, but were you and the administration, the White House, the press secretary said it was the White House idea and they insisted on it because it would be so horrible. Were you contacted by the White House before they insisted on the sequester?
Well,
about the ramifications that...
I mean, we all obviously had our input into the idea that if there was a sequester, there would be shared pain across the administration.
But when they proposed it, you were not asked about specific...
We didn't take a vote on it.
Okay. I'm sure you did. And I appreciate that candor. Question about nationwide investments. There's been concern about how we as a government can address transportation problems, obviously, that affect us system-wide, nationwide, and how we resolve moving freight from the West Coast ports inland, and how we resolve the bottlenecks in places like Chicago and Fort Worth or the choked I-95 corridor. In safety lieu, the authorizers tried to create a program for projects of regional and national significance, but that all got earmarked. And in the stimulus bill, the Senate tried to address it by creating Tiger, which seems to hang around forever. But and MAP 21 created a one-year authorization for a national Tiger-like program, but didn't continue that authorization for 2014. Apparently, that was not a priority. Can you give us any evidence that DOT is using the discretionary program to address nationwide projects?
Sure.
Is there any office or program or anything at the department that looks at this on a nationwide basis?
Oh. Sylvia runs the TIFIA program.
And she should. She'll do it well.
And that's a program that you all provided a lot of additional money. The TIFIA program is a loan program. We have about $800 million this year and over $1 billion next year. That money was provided in MAP 21. It was a way to say that big projects need to have an opportunity to leverage other dollars. And we just announced that we're going to consider a loan to completely redo the Riverwalk along the Chicago River. We're working with New York on a large bridge project, the Tappan Zee Bridge project. They've submitted a letter. I think we have about how many letters? So we have 29 letters of interest for the TIFIA loan program. And almost all of these, Mr. Chairman, are projects of national significance. They're big projects. They're projects that can't be funded out of any one pot of money. They need private dollars, which is what TIFIA really...
The Riverwalk in Chicago is a project of national
significance. Yeah, the Chicago River is a natural resource that can benefit thousands of people come to Chicago.
Well,
yeah.
We have a Riverwalk in Des Moines.
Fine, submit a letter. We'd be happy to take a look at it.
Oh, we got several. We flood all the time. Why didn't you propose funding the authorized projects of National Regional Significance Program? And if we're going to provide funding in 2014 for Tiger, wouldn't it make sense to go with an authorized program rather than one that was... made up.
Well, look at Mr. Chairman. We don't pass the bills. You all do that, and you have put we now have a Tiger 5 program that we're announcing $475 million for. We didn't dream that up. That was passed by Congress. You all like Tiger. Somebody around here does. We've had five programs, and what it funds are innovative, creative projects that there's no other place to get the money from. Some of which are in Iowa, by the way, which I'll be happy to provide you a list of. These are opportunities for communities to come to DOT with innovative, creative ideas, and there's no other pot of money. And Congress seems to like it because you've given us five different opportunities to...
Is it authorized?
No, sir, it is not. We don't authorize programs. That's your job.
Right.
But if you give us the money, there are plenty of places around the country that are clamoring for... ways to innovate in transportation.
How much of that is going to go to, quote, high-speed rail? And it was interesting earlier, you said the department never looks at speed or time to get somewhere as a consideration of projects. Isn't high-speed rail, whatever that is, supposed to get people there faster?
We've never promoted high-speed rail as... on the speed aspect of it. In Illinois, they invested over $3 billion to fix up the tracks to get trains from Chicago to St. Louis going from 79 miles per hour to 110. That was their decision. In California, they have a plan in place that they've been working on for 10 years where we've invested over $3 billion. Their trains will go 200 miles an hour. On the Northeast Corridor, we've invested over $3 billion. Not to get trains to go faster, although Amtrak is working on that. It's to fix up 50-year-old aging catenary and infrastructure. So our investments go where there are governors or stakeholders, some who want to fix up infrastructure, some who want to buy new cars, some who want trains to go faster.
With the announcements you're going to have on the, quote, Tiger 5, is there high-speed rail money in that?
No, there's no earmark. There's no earmark for any program. No. If you look at the notice that'll be out on Friday, it just simply says there's $475 million. And
$475 million.
That's correct. Okay. Yes. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Mr. Dent, are you ready? Well, go to Mr. Dent. Thank you. I'm sorry, Mr. Pastor.
Yeah.
You don't want to recognize me anymore. You quit that. Talking about sequestration, I agree with you. It's a bad idea, and we did vote, and I voted no for her because it was a bad idea then. So, but we have to live with its ramifications. I'm going to go back to the control towers. 149 in April. They're going to be shut down, but then made the decision that we'd go into June. Now, as an example, and why I'm asking the question, in Glendale, there's a control tower that is in very close proximity to Luke Air Force Base. Luke Air Force Base is getting the F-35s, and it's always been a high priority for FAA because you have Luke so close to the traffic coming from Glendale and Maricopa County that the control tower had some significance in terms of safety. And so I'm going to ask the question this way. In the determination of going from April to June, will there be consideration on the different airports that were deemed to be closed to say, because of different factors, we're now going to take this airport off the list? Is this one of the reasons that you went from April to June, or what is the reason?
In the beginning, Mr. Pastor, we did consult with our colleagues at the Defense Department about airports that were near military facilities, and we consulted with our colleagues at the Defense Department when there were airports that had air guard air guard units on those airports. And we went with their judgment on this. And we asked them, we didn't want to close a tower if it was going to have an impact on something that the Defense Department thought that would be a serious detriment to their to the unit that's there or to an airport nearby. And the reason that we extended the time was to give our lawyers really more opportunity to answer some of the concerns that had been put forth by the plaintiffs, and also to give airports an opportunity. Some airports are actually going to put the money up to keep these open, because in the president's 2014 budget, there's money for these airports. And so some communities are finding the resources to keep the airports open. And frankly, we want, number one, it was for legal reasons, but number two, it was to give communities a chance to see if they could find their own resources.
I'm going to yield back and wait for my next round, go into a different line of questioning.
All right. Thank you very much, Mr. Pastor. Mr. Dan?
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. Good morning, Mr. Secretary.
Morning.
Great to see you again.
Thank you.
Just a few things. Map 21, as you know, was an important step toward improving our nation's transportation infrastructure and systems, as well as maximizing efficiencies within the department. I recognize the department is working to implement the reforms and promulgate regulations directed by the new law. I'm interested in your prioritization of these initiatives in the constrained budgetary environment. Specifically, I want to highlight an issue one of my constituents has brought to my attention. For a few years now, a company in my district that has voiced serious concerns about the Federal Motor Carrier Safety Administration Hazardous Materials Safety Permit Program, HMSP, I guess. As you are probably aware, this is a safety permit program for motor carriers of certain hazardous materials. It is intended to ensure a higher fitness standard than is required of regular trucking companies. Under the program, a carrier's fitness is based solely on limited out-of-service violation history. My constituent's frustrations are twofold. He believes the standards used to evaluate carriers do not accurately measure safety. And two, current rules do not provide an appeals process prior to automatically being denied a permit. These seemingly arbitrary rulings are having real consequences and effect on their livelihoods, and actually it favors very large companies over smaller companies. Pursuant to MAP 21, Federal Motor Carrier Safety Administration is conducting a study of hazardous material safety permit program. That study should be completed this summer, as I'm told, and reported to Congress by an October 1st deadline. Mr. Secretary, I want to acknowledge that your agencies have been extremely responsive to my office when we've made inquiries, and I want to thank them for their professionalism that they've always extended to me and to my office. And I know Administrator Farrow has been personally engaged on this. I'm just looking for your commitment that you'll seriously consider this industry stakeholder feedback in the HMSP study and pursue recommendations highlighted in that report. In the meantime, I'd simply ask that you utilize your agencies to the fullest extent possible to review where you have authority to pursue administrative remedies and expedite interim resolutions as soon as possible. This is a big issue where I live.
Sure, of course you have my commitment to listen to your constituent and to listen to you and see if there's a way that we can be helpful.
Well, thank you. It's a very important issue to us. I just wanted to just make you aware of it. And the second, obviously on the issue of the contract tower program, the administration's decision to close those contract towers has gathered a lot of attention, obviously. Since the administration originally slated the first round of closures of, 149 towers to begin on April 7th, but I guess now decided to delay the closures until June 15th, how do you plan to keep these 149 towers open until June 15th if, as the administration has claimed, you don't have any flexibility on those cuts?
Well, we found the money to do it, and that's why we went to court and asked for the extension.
Do you foresee any further revisions to the list of the 149 contract tower closures now that the FAA will be funding the towers at least until...
I think the only revision would come if a community came to us and said we have the money to keep the tower open. We don't have the money to keep them open. We just simply don't. And let me just say too, Mr. Dent, this has been painful. As I said to Mr. Pastore, as someone who represented a fairly rural district, I know how important these airports are. And I know there's going to be job loss when an airport tower closes. And an airport closes.
Yeah, I just want to say, I know in my district, the one contract tower feels they could manage this without a closure, responsibly and within budget. I just wanted to share that with you.
Well, we have told airports, if you can find the money to keep your airport open, we'll make sure the paperwork gets done so that can happen.
Okay.
We will not stand in the way.
Okay. Thank you. That's I'll deliver that message back to them. Thank you, Mr. Secretary. And finally, I know you're familiar with my interest in pipeline safety, and I certainly appreciated your visit to my district back in 2011, shortly after that terrible explosion in Allentown that killed five people. And so I wanted to thank you for all the work you've done on pipeline safety. Obviously, we've made some positive progress on the issue with the Pipeline Safety and Job Creation Act of 2011. I see that yearly inspections rose 46% in 2011 to 1,340. And PHMSA has fulfilled the goal of hiring 135 inspection enforcement staff. I know PHMSA has experienced challenges in filling vacancies, and I noted that there was a request for direct hiring authority. I wanted to see if you could comment on those issues.
Well, first of all, let me say thank you to you for your leadership and to Congress for passing a very, very strong pipeline safety bill that gave us the authority to hire additional people. We have all of the people that you authorized, we have hired, and you'll see from the president's budget, we're asking for additional inspectors. We think that's the way to really correct the problem. And we appreciate what Congress has done.
Thank you, sir.
The gentleman's time has expired. I apologize to Mr. Joyce. I actually recognize Mr. Dent out of turn there since you arrived earlier. But Mr. Quigley.
Thank you again, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Secretary, I know you're occasionally fond of pointing out that we created many of these Frankenstein legislative monsters that you have to address. Well, here's at least one more. The pilot program in MAP 21 that helps get programs through an expedited fashion through development, engineering, and construction. Some of it's through a public-private partnership. As you know, there's a little provision in there that says they have to be in a state of good repair to be eligible for this, which means almost no one who's a large entity is eligible to qualify for what could be a very helpful program. Could you comment on that? And
what I'd like to do, Mr. Quigley, is check with some of our administrators and see if that language has inhibited us from really moving ahead. I don't have the specifics on that. I'm aware that Congress wanted to cut short the time within which we approve projects, but I need to really look at what we've been doing on that. I don't have a good answer for you, but I'll get it for you.
I appreciate it. I mean, it seems to be contradictory here. Is the agencies that need this most would be the ones least eligible for those funds. So what I appreciate if you get back to us and or our staffs. Talking a little bit about core capacity, I believe it's $120 million in FY14. Can you comment on the process for how that's going to be allocated for 2014, whether it'll be a competitive process for those funds?
Again, I'll have to get back to you. Rather than just trying to talk off the top of my head on that, I'd rather get you the specifics.
Okay, that's fine. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I would yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Quigley. Mr. Joyce.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Morning, Secretary.
Good morning.
In your 2014 budget, I noticed that there was yet another tax on the commercial aviation industry. And a matter of fact, it's a $100 per aircraft departure tax, which would cost our nation's airlines roughly $1 billion annually. Passengers already pay more than their fair share of taxes, roughly 20% on every fare that's out there, and on a round-trip fare. In the future of Aviation Advisory Committee that you convened in 2010, identified the raising aviation tax burden as an obstacle to the viability and global competitiveness of the airline industry, which lost over $50 billion and nearly one-third of its workforce over the past decade. Are you concerned about the rising federal aviation tax burden? And second, did your department conduct an economic impact analysis on the proposed departure tax?
This is a proposal that the administration has promoted for 4 years, or at least during the time that we have put forth budgets, and it is a way to raise some income. And the answer to your question, whether we did an economic study, I don't know that we did, but I'll make it available to you.
Well, that'd be great. By chance, did you do? Is there the same type of taxes on the railroad industry?
There's no tax like this on the rail, on freight rail.
Is there any tax on any other industry similar to what you were doing to the aviation industry?
Well, look, we have jurisdiction over a lot of transportation industries. Rather than just saying no, let me make sure I know what I'm talking about.
I appreciate that, considering it's probably the safest form of travel in the nation. We would certainly want to make it competitive, wouldn't we? Or keep it competitive.
Aviation. We have the safest aviation system in the world.
Secondly, sir, and I apologize because I was late, but three hearings at one time make it a little rough to be here. On next gen, did you discuss that when you gave your remarks?
No, I didn't. Other than to say that the president's budget does continue our substantial resources for NextGen, and we've made very good progress on NextGen in implementing it around the country, and we will continue to do that. The FAA bill provides significant resources to over the next couple of years to really make progress.
Well, better integrate those and develop processes for new performance-based navigation procedures and ensure stakeholders have needed information on NextGen to facilitate investment decisions like the GAO had requested. Does DOT agree with those recommendations?
I'd have to go back and look and see what they said.
Well, they said that the FAA should better integrate NextGen efforts, develop processes for selecting new performance-based navigation procedures, and ensure that stakeholders have needed information on NextGen progress to facilitate investment.
I'm sure we've done all of that.
But do you think NextGen will be implemented within the proposed timeline, and what barriers would you foresee?
The one big barrier is sequestration. It's a big headache for us. It's going to eliminate some of the resources. Either for the people, I mean, when we're furloughing FAA employees, and we've told them that the furlough would be up to 11 days, some of those people are working on NextGen. So that the process is going to be slowed down by that.
But wouldn't NextGen make the airline or make the whole issue more efficient eliminate the need for towers if everything progressed the way you see it?
Well, we've never said that next gen. What we've said about next gen is that it'll make flying safe, guiding planes in and out of airports more directly, save jet fuel.
Correct.
And relieve congestion around major airports.
And require major investments by not only the government, but also by the airline industry.
Of course, and we've talked extensively with the airlines about that.
So it'd be fair to them keep going forward with this investment in their industry? If are we going to be able to keep up ours?
We're going to keep up. This is our, at FAA, safety is our number one priority, but implementation of next gen is what people work on every day, and we have a good plan.
I appreciate your work. Thank you very
thank
much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Joyce. Complete the round here, Ms. Herrera-Butler.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I guess I'm a little baffled to hear all this talk about concern over sequestration when you're supporting the most expensive light rail build in the country, and it's the most expensive by over $100 million per mile. But since it looks like safety is a huge issue for you all and for us, whether it's FAA or highways or transit, and you rightly pointed out this is a regional bridge and safety is the issue. It's obviously not to get people or freight moved more quickly over the bridge. It's safety. Is the DOT still interested in this regional bridge and the safety of it if we locally choose to put a different form of mass transit on the bridge other than light rail?
We will work with stakeholders, governors, members of Congress, elected officials on projects where we think it's important for the region and for the safety of the region. But I want to be clear about this, and this is what I said when I was in your state recently. If the people that have been working on this for 10 years, and now there are other people in place that want to substitute their judgment for the people who put this plan in place.
What people are you talking about?
Planners.
Planners.
Previous governors. Previous legislators who have passed money in order for this project to go ahead. Communities.
Well, not my community recently voted down funding for
this. This is a regional project. I know that there's one community and one county out of multiple counties and multiple communities that doesn't want this. I get that.
Let me clarify. We want you to invest and make this safer. We believe that's your responsibility.
If you don't like the transit piece of this, so be it. If you don't like it, so be it. Start over, though.
So
that's what you have to do.
Let me reclaim my time on that, Mr. Secretary. Reclaiming my time.
Yeah, fine, go ahead.
This project's been redesigned 2 times in the last 3 years, completely redesigned. You didn't pull your funding then. So are you saying that the only way we're going to get the federal support is if we have light rail? Is that the only way that you're interested?
If you take the light rail out of this project, mm-hmm. you take a major component part out of it, you start the environmental impact statement over
again. They didn't start the environmental impact statement over when they redesigned it 2 years ago because they hadn't designed it properly. Those people you talked about who've designed it for the last 10 years engineered a bridge that didn't pass engineering muster. So there have been some necessary modifications. As it currently stands, the Coast Guard and the Army Corps of Engineers cannot permit this bridge as it's built because the light rail deck on the bottom makes it too short. There are companies in my region who cannot pass under the bridge if they build it as it is. So it's right now not even permitted. So you're telling me the only way we're going to get this money is if we build this bridge that is too low with the light rail on it. That's the only way that you're interested in, and you feel beholden to previous governors over the citizens in this region?
We take our cues from the people that are in charge.
Well, guess what? I'm one of those now. And the folks in my region are saying we need to do better with their money. And I would argue that they would want us to consider freight mobility and people moving faster, not just the safety. Safety's huge. That's the federal responsibility. But to ask them to pay tolls and taxes, this one community is going to pay the lion's share. And for you to say that there are previous working groups that we are beholden to, not the American taxpayer. That baffles me. Are you not concerned about the cost coming out of this community that's had double-digit unemployment over the last 4 years?
I believe that having been at a meeting with the Coast Guard, that the matter of the permit will be settled. I've also know that there are now three businesses that are being talked to about their opportunities and the way to mitigate the business that they will lose. And I think those issues will be resolved.
So, having met with the exact same folks several times, one of those businesses, one job for them is a $500 million manufacturing job. So we're talking about a lot of jobs in our region, manufacturers, workers, on just one. There's no way to change or mitigate for them. And I know that you all have been talking to them because they keep bringing it up. In that, are you saying that, and back to the original point, the U.S. DOT is only interested in this project if the mitigation, say the mitigation is we change the form of mass transit, we change it from light rail to bus rapid transit. Are you saying then that the DOT wouldn't consider that mitigation? They wouldn't then also be supportive of putting that form on the bridge?
Well, I've never heard any discussions with any business people where they want to change the light rail. They're more interested in raising the height of the bridge, which I believe the Coast Guard is looking at now. And if you have an objection to the transit, and that's a major portion of this project, it changes the project. I don't make this stuff up. This is the law. It's federal law that was passed by Congress. Start over with another environmental impact statement that reflects what the project is going to look like and where the money's going to come from. Hold public hearings so everybody knows.
Can I respond to that if you're going to keep going? Or should I wait?
Go ahead.
I guess they've already redesigned the project a couple of times without you all requiring them to start over. And I'll provide for your office a list of areas where you all have circumvented or have at least skirted current law to move this forward. So I'm very anxious to follow the law in this process, Mr. Secretary, and I would hope the department is as well.
Gentlewoman's time's expired. We'll start a new round. Yeah. All right. Mr. Secretary, your rail reauthorization proposal totaled $6.6 billion in FY14, which is obviously an extremely large increase compared to FY13 level of $1.54 billion. I found it concerning that it was proposing a shift of responsibility from the states and private industry to the federal government. For example, the Rail Authorization Act passed 5 years ago mandated that private rail firms install positive train control by December of 2015 on their own track. Your budget proposes that the federal government fund the positive train control on Amtrak routes and commuter rail lines. In addition, your budget proposal to transfer $85 million from the states for Amtrak state-supported routes to the federal government. Why are you proposing to shift the burden to the federal government, especially with our current budgetary concerns?
You mean on passenger rail?
Yeah.
Because it's go ahead.
Positive train control, right.
This is a very expensive proposition, and it's also a mandate from Congress, and it's also a priority.
Apparently it has not been an issue of money. The private rail firms pay for this, and in August, the FRA's report indicated delays are associated with technical issues, such as spectrum, and not necessarily with any funding issue. So I don't understand why we want to shift it to us rather than have the original deal as far as who was going to pay for it.
We consider positive train control our number one safety priority.
It is huge.
And we believe that in order to implement it, we have to put some money where our mouth is.
Are you saying it's a money issue rather than a technical issue?
I would say that the technical aspect of this is not as critical as how do you pay for it.
That's not what the FRA is saying, though.
Well, the FRA is resolving the technical aspects of it with the railroads.
Okay.
If you're asking me which is more of a problem, it's the money part.
Okay, but again, that's not what they said. Okay. Going back to one of our favorite subjects, the stimulus bill provided $8 billion for a new high-speed rail program. And the fiscal year 2010 bill provided another $2.5 billion for high-speed rail. After $10.5 billion in 5 years, do we have anything that looks like a nationwide investment in high-speed rail? And do we even have one corridor that's been noticeably improved, either passenger or freight, after the $10.5 billion of taxpayer investment?
Well, we've invested over $3 billion in the Northeast Corridor. And we have trains running there very regularly. Part of that investment is in infrastructure. Part of the investment is in states where governors have wanted to increase service or fix up infrastructure. In Illinois, we've invested almost $3 billion, all of it in infrastructure to fix up the tracks. And I've ridden on those trains from Chicago, the train from Chicago to St. Louis. And I've seen where the money has been spent. In California, they will break ground on their high-speed rail initiative this year. We've invested over $3 billion. The assembly there voted last summer to sell bonds upwards of between $6 and $8 billion as part of their investment. We've made a lot of progress in four short years. In four short years. It took us 50 years to build the interstate system. And the idea is that this is a major infrastructure program. And it's not going to be built overnight.
Define high-speed rail.
Pardon me?
Define high-speed
rail. Well, the Congress defines high-speed rail as 110 miles per hour. That's the way they've defined it in legislation. California's trains will, from San Francisco to San Diego, will go 200 miles an hour. In Illinois, the trains, once the infrastructure investments are completed, will go 110 miles per hour. It's going to be difficult to get trains consistently to go 110 miles per hour on the Northeast Corridor.
Well, and they have to be electrified to be able to do the high speeds, right?
The California trains will be electrified.
And not...
The one in Illinois is not electrified.
The initial operating segment in California will not be electrified.
The part in Fresno, that's the reason they're building it there, so they can put the catenary up and use it as a test area.
Okay. Mr. Pastor, I see my time's expired.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. As you know, the House has passed its budget. The Senate has its budget. You're now talking about the administration's budget, but if there be a resolution of all three budgets, maybe way down the road. And as appropriators, after we finish the hearings, I'm sure we're going to have, we'll start the markups. And I would assume that the allocations that will be given out will be probably based on the Ryan budget that passed the House. And the question is, it's going to be hard to accommodate many of your requests that you've done in this budget. What would be your priorities in terms of now 4 years of Secretary of Transportation? What do you think would be the priorities that you think need to be continued as we go forward in appropriating the money for fiscal year 2014?
I think we will always have safety as our number one priority in all modes of transportation. Whether it's aviation or truck or cars, our NHTSA organization is the top safety agency in the world. People come from all over the world to talk to our staff on safety. They're the best. They're the ones that rate cars. They're the ones that implemented 20 years ago, click it or ticket, and now 86% of us buckle up. They're the ones that work with Mothers Against Drunk Driving, and we've taken a lot of drunk drivers off the road. They're the ones that got states to pass 0.08. And so it'll always be safety, Mr. Pastor. If you're asking in terms of programs, we have to keep our roads and bridges in a state of good repair. We do have a state-of-the-art interstate system, and we have to make sure that we maintain our interstate system and our bridges so that they are safe. But in terms of new initiatives, there's no secret around here about what the president's vision is for the next generation of transportation. That's high-speed rail. That's the president's vision. He announced it 4 years ago. We've invested $12 billion. I've been to 18 countries looking at high-speed rail, and the common theme in every country is a federal investment, a national government investment, the way that we did with the interstate system. The only way we're going to have a high-speed rail program in America is if the federal government steps up and makes the investment. We've invested a lot in other forms of transportation, like light rail in your state, streetcars in other communities, bus rapid transit in other communities. So we tried to work with our partners, whether they be governors or mayors or planners, to do what we can in communities to try and meet their needs. So safety number one, state of good repair for our roads and bridges, making sure that they're safe. And but in terms of the next generation of transportation, it's high-speed rail.
In that component that you describe as safety, is that next gen?
Next gen is a big part of it. We have the safest aviation system in the world. And next gen will only enhance that.
I heard you say that air traffic controllers were going to be furloughed maybe up to 11 days. And the input that air traffic controllers or some air traffic controllers have in the development of next gen is very important. And I'm assuming that they are participating.
They are participating. They're on all of our committees and all of our working groups, and they're an intimate part of it. They have to be.
And we've been wanting to implement next gen in the near future. But with sequestration in the way, what's going to happen to that timeline?
It's going to slow down our ability to meet the timetables that we've set for next gen.
Do you have any idea to what extent?
Well, we've told employees that they're going to be furloughed up to 11 days. We hope it's not 11 days, but it's up to 11 days. Some of these people are working on these projects. But I want to assure you and every member of the committee, safety will not be compromised.
Well, I just, talking about safety, it's the Homeland Security who made the decision. Has FAA or Secretary, or Transportation, taken a comment on bringing the changes in the Homeland Security on what can be brought on planes?
That's not in my portfolio.
But safety on airlines, safety on different modes of transportation is. So do you have, does the department have any comment or in ensuring that the airlines are safe and people that work in the industry are safe?
For all of the things that we have jurisdiction over, safety remains our number one priority.
Thank you, Mr. Secretary.
All right. I will just, on that subject, on the next gen, I think one of the biggest delays that has happened was the previous administration when they did not include the controllers in the whole development of the of next gen.
Well, we had
and
the
purpose, which is.
Well, they had the contract issues, so that was.
Well, that was. The people running it should be involved in designing them.
Yeah, but you all, look, you all deserve credit for passing an FAA bill. I mean, we went without a bill for almost 6 or 7 years, and now with the passage of the bill, we have the resources to do it.
Right. We digress. Mr. Dent.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Secretary, just one final question, and thanks again for all the work you've done here at the department these last few years. We'll miss you. I guess this may be your last hearing.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll miss you. And thanks for the good work you've done. Just one quick question. In 2012, this subcommittee identified flaws in the NHTSA National Automotive Sampling System and provided funding to fully modernize the data collection system. The volume of crash data being input into the system is coming in at 20% of the volume that was originally intended for the database. Additionally, the quality of the data has diminished. If properly implemented and maintained, this database is going to provide important data to support policy decisions and be an invaluable tool to all stakeholders by providing feedback on which technologies truly are improving highway safety and which ones are not working. Stakeholders in my district have voiced concern that NHTSA's plans for modernization are not clearly defined. Could I please ask you to get back to me on the status of the modernization?
Sure.
We'll
do it.
Thank you. And how much of the $25 million has been spent to date?
Okay.
And how is NHTSA engaging with interested parties, suppliers, automakers, safety advocates, the medical community, research organizations, to ensure that we're leveraging both public and private resources to the greatest
sure.
extent possible?
Yep, we'll do it.
That's it. I mean, I don't expect an answer right now.
Yep.
Just to have the staff.
Yeah, we'll get back to you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And I'll yield back. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Dent. Ms. Herrera-Butler.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. To follow up on the last part when we were talking about the CRC and the bridge height issue and actions that DOT has taken to mitigate or hopefully mitigate, one of the things that I think is important for you all to consider, I know there are three businesses and we'll see what happens. My hope, this is the third or fourth, depending on who you talk to, largest river system in the country. It serves all the way up, obviously the Columbia River, all the way up into Idaho and all the four states surrounding. The ag industries use this river traffic. Is it wise to look at this project and say, okay, we're going to mitigate for these two or three businesses that are there now, and we're not going to worry about future growth and capacity as long as we can get these three businesses mitigated, moved over? We're not going to worry about the bridge height or the cap that it puts on the river. Is that in terms of impeding the flow of commerce, is that of concern?
We would take our cues on that from the people that live in the area. I mean, the reason that we became aware of the height issue is when businesses came to us. And we recognized that it was a problem. Mm-hmm. And that's when the mitigation really began. If the leadership in the community, the business community and others say, you know, other businesses are going to be inhibited or the future growth for the economy, we would certainly listen to that, of course.
Well, and I think, I don't know if we CC'd you, but I know that we sent to the Coast Guard, the members of Congress who live up the river, in the different districts, sent a letter in saying just that, because there's public ports that go up beyond us. That's not my district or my area, but folks have raised that same concern. And just to clarify, come back to your interest in this project in the region, would DOT still be willing to fund a regional bridge that increases safety or makes it safe in the event of a catastrophic earthquake or so on, if the transit portion were something other than light rail?
Well, that decision hasn't been made. And until the decision is made, we're operating under the assumption that the plan that's in place is the one that has been selected. And so I'm not going to answer a hypothetical. Given the fact that there's 10 years of planning and there's a project in place and one state has already passed their local match and we're waiting to see what the other state does. If your state decides to do something different and doesn't want to put up the match, then we'll see where that takes us.
So I guess I'm gauging your interest in the safety of the bridge irrespective of what mode of transit is used on it. not whether or not each state believes the bridge needs to be built or what they want to put in for.
Well,
the controversy is over the mode of transit.
Let me be clear. We like this project. This is the one multimodal project in the country of national significance. If this project is built, you'll become a model, maybe for the world, but certainly for the country, where two states and a region that connects North America can build a multimodal bridge. So, we like this project.
So can I ask you to consider a few things? I realize it looks good on paper and it adds to the talking points. But the really important thing in my mind is, obviously you all have not drilled down into whether this even pencils. Did you know that we have to build parking garages in downtown Vancouver to meet the density requirements for light rail? Do you know that it does not pencil in our region? I mean, what you're bringing over from Portland is actually in the red, and part of the reason we're rejecting it is we don't want to have to pay off their debts. If you were willing to truly make it a multimodal project that meets, and what you said, meets, work with communities to meet their needs, you would be flexible and balanced and willing to help change this into, add bus rapid transit, add something that we can afford and that meets our needs. We literally have to build parking garages and assume people are going to drive to those parking garages for us to be legal to get the New Starts grant. That to me seems like you're really pounding a square peg into a round hole.
Well, the idea that we're not flexible is not accurate at all. When somebody came to us and said the bridge isn't high enough and it's going to impact businesses, what did we do? We went to the Coast Guard.
Coast Guard has not permitted it.
Let me finish. The idea that we're not flexible is not true. We have shown a lot of flexibility.
You're telling me that unless we do the bridge as you like it, you won't give me the hypothetical yes that you're still involved.
We're trying to mitigate with the businesses who asked for a higher bridge so they can accommodate their businesses. That sounds like a lot of flexibility to me.
Thank you.
Everyone's time has expired, and I think we're going to adjourn the hearing here. Ask unanimous consent that members are allowed to revise and extend their remarks, and if you would respond to written,
I sure will.
Questions
absolutely
may have. I just on a personal note, and I hope Mr. Pastor would join me. But thank you for your service at the department. We hate to see you leave.
Thank you.
So we don't always agree on every issue. You defend the indefensible pretty well sometimes.
Well, let me add my thanks to this this committee for always having transportation as one of your top priorities. You've all been great to work with. Thank you.
And you should be commended for your safety initiatives. Texting, the distracted driver stuff is really a huge step forward.
Thank you.
Commend you for that.
Thank you.
Unless there's anything else, Mr. Pastor, we will adjourn the hearing.